Pastor Valencia gave a beautiful exposition of 2 Timothy. Today I conclude that the entire 2 Timothy, the life of Paul, as it were, looking at Paul's ministry. And you can look at it as a final farewell to the person who knew that the end had come. So looking back as a reflection on his own life and as a way of encouraging his protege, Timothy, the crowning touch. Please let us pray. You call us by your love. You encourage us through your love. And above all, you empower us through your Spirit to do what you call us to do. Thank you for all this, for Christ's sake. Amen. The coaching staff at Central High School in Claremont, Florida, was having a little problem. The football players were stealing the jerseys used in football practice. They just disappeared. The coaches thought they could solve the problem by printing something on their jerseys. And so they went out to print something like stolen from Central High School. In that case, if you wore one, they would have stolen it. But guess what? It didn't work. So the coach had a great score. And he ordered new practice jerseys and printed on them, Central High School is number 4. Guess what? Not a single one of the jerseys disappeared. Here's the point. We want to be winners, at least to be identified with winners or achievers. Would you like to be number 4? That is a clear testimony of St. Paul as he writes to his young friend and disciple, Timothy. Paul had founded the church in Ephesus and had specifically put this young man there. And in tough times, he would write to him, encourage him. But here, the end had come. And as the text shows, in my previous one, here in my second, so it was his second imprisonment in Rome, and that was the end. Apparently, he was executed. So the crucial question is, looking at Paul's life, was he a winner? In some respect, he may be the second most important, most famous person, maybe next to Jesus Christ. I count this as being a winner. But was lying to St. Paul easy? Hardly. He faced many tests along the way. People who are truly victorious in life always, always to be prepared for tests. And champion faced most difficult tests. You know it, and I know it. There is this amusing story about a test that was being given at the University of Georgia. The basketball players were given some special tests. The university's assistant coach, Jim Harrop Jr., came under fire in 2004 with an NCAA investigation because of some of the tests he gave to the basketball players. Just listen to a sampling. How many halves are in a college basketball game? How many points does a 3-point field goal account for in a basketball game? And this one. What basic colors are the uniforms the Georgia Bulldogs wear in home games? Guess what? According to Coach Harris' records, every one of the students had an A on this test. Even the students who didn't take the test had an A. Not a test. Surprise. Paul the Apostle didn't face any test like that one, my friends. His tests were demanding. He never had the comforts of family life. He spent years traveling under very primitive conditions. He was persecuted. He was beaten, thrown in prison, and eventually. rise. Life was never easy. But you've heard that it is not what happens to you that counts, but how you handle what happens to you. Paul handled his life in a very magnificent way. So listen to some of his final words written to his friend Timothy. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but also to all who have longed for its appearing. I have fought. I have finished. I have kept. St. Paul gives young Timothy a deep spiritual mentoring based on his experience. In today's lesson, he provides a crowning touch to his ministry in three ways. Number one, a life well lived. Number two, a race well run. Number three, a crown much deserved. A life well lived. A race well run, a crown much deserved. Number one, Paul is looking back over a life well lived. He will stand before his Lord as one with no regrets. And in fact, authentic life is when you look back and say, I did my best, I tried. No regrets. Did he have a perfect life? Not at all. He had made mistakes, sometimes very grievous mistakes. Remember, it was this same Paul who was part of the persecution of the early Christians. And he was there when the first deacon, Stephen, was murdered. Christ took his life. He confessed again and again. In fact, everything he wrote, he reminded himself that Christ had forgiven him and empowered him for bigger tasks. In the 1950s, a tabloid magazine called Confidential came under fire for publishing some scandalous stories about Hollywood biggest stars. Many of the stars, concerned for their public image, banded together to convince the powerful movie studios to press charges against this tabloid. The studio bosses pulled a few strings, and soon the Attorney General of the State of California filed charges against Robert Harrison, the publisher of Confidential, for, quote, conspiracy to commit criminal libel. The fervent hope in the showbiz community was that the trial would bankrupt this publisher and it would shut up instead of just meddling into the affairs of these movie stars, to remind them that their lives were opulent. But Harrison turned the tables against the prosecutors. His lawyers called more than 200 of Hollywood's biggest stars, people like Clive Gable and Elizabeth Taylor, to testify to the truth of the stories he had published. Suddenly, Hollywood was in a serious bind. If they told the truth, many careers would be ruined. If they lied, it would be perjury, a very serious crime. So a strange thing began to happen as the trial drew near. Hundreds of movie stars suddenly disappeared. Many went on extended vacations overseas. One actress hid in the trunk of her car and had a friend drive her to Mexico. Many of the lesser known witnesses in the trial died mysteriously. Ironically, this turn of events worked against Robert Harrison anyway. There was no one there to back up his stories. So he eventually settled the case out of court. Here's my point. Paul the Apostle did not need to hide in a trunk when he came to face judgment before his maker. He didn't need to flee abroad. The final letters, part of what we just read, showed that he was courageous and I did my best. What a great feeling. Please note how he opened the second letter to Timothy. I am grateful to God, who I worship with a clear conscience, as my ancestors did, when I remember you constantly in my prayers, night and day. I hope all of us, working out our faith with fear and trembling, can stand before our Maker in the end with a clear conscience and report the one and the life well lived. Secondly, Paul could also report a race well run. Life is a marathon, isn't it? And we all will be judged by where we start. But most importantly, where we finish. Now, you and I should not think that we need to be as a Paul in order to be worthy servants of Christ. No. Theologian and seminary professor Dr. Fred Craddock once said something very profound. Professor Craddock said, "To give my life for Christ appears glorious. To pour myself out for others, to pay the ultimate price of martyrdom, I will do it. I'm ready, Lord, to go out in a blaze of glory." Then he adds, "We think going all out to the Lord is taking a $1,000 bill and laying it on the table. Here's my life, Lord, I'm giving it to you." But the reality for most of us is that he sends us to the bank and has us cash $1,000 for quarters, not in notes. We go through like putting out 25 cents here, 50 cents there, listen to the neighbor's case struggle instead of saying, "Get lost." Go to a committee meeting to make decisions that affect communities. Give a cup of water to a shaky old man in a nursing home. Usually, giving our life to Christ isn't glorious. It's done in all those acts, 25 cents at a time. It could be easy to go out in the flash of glory, but it's harder to live the life of a Christian little by little over a long haul. Paul the Apostle put in his $4,000, 25 cents at a time, in many ways, the lives he touched. It was not easy. But why did he do it? What kept him going? What was his motivation? One thing, his life for Christ, who called him, forgave him, and commissioned him. Pastor Kent Crockett puts it this way. Imagine a Second World War soldier wounded while courageously rescuing his fellow soldiers. When he returned home, he was rewarded with a Medal of Honor for his service. What had motivated him to put his life at stake in danger for his fellow soldiers? He risked his life to save his friends' lives and to defend his country's freedom. When his life was at stake in battle, he wasn't thinking, "Hey, I am doing it because I'm going to get a Medal of Honor." The reward was simply the nation's way of showing appreciation for his heroic actions. In the same way, we serve God because we love God and our fellows. We don't serve for the reward, but for the Lord. As Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 9, we have as our ambition God. St. Paul was one of the most contented people who ever lived. Why? His was a life well lived, a race well run. And above all, one more thing, he received a crown well deserved. Folks, we don't talk about our heavenly rewards these days. It used to be here, your reward is in heaven. Now you tell someone, your reward is heaven, say, "Give me some McDonald's right now." Also, we try to do that as a way of guarding against self-righteousness. We try to emphasize that no one wins God's favor. It is given as a true gift. That's our theology. Having said that, there is a clear strain of scripture teaching that indicates that there is a reward to those who are faithful to the end. a crown of life, a crowning touch, as it were, would bestow the last day. So St. Paul would write with courage and conviction, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. There is a story about a world-class woman marathon runner who was invited to compete in a road race somewhere in Connecticut. On the morning of the race, she drove from New York City, following directions, or she thought she was following directions given her over the phone. She got lost, stopped at a gas station, and asked for help. She knew that the race started in the parking lot of a shopping mall. The station attendant also knew of such a race scheduled just up the road and directed her to that spot. When she arrived, she was relieved to see that the parking lot a modest number of runners. Not as many as she anticipated. And so she thought this would be a very easy race. She hurried to the registration desk, announced herself, and was surprised that her name was not even on the list. So the attendant said, well, if you just put on your jersey immediately, get ready, you are off to start when the gun goes off. She ran, and naturally, she won easily. Some 4 minutes ahead for the first male runner. Only after the race, when there was no envelope containing her sizable prize and performance money, did she confirm that the event she had run was not the race she had been invited to. She's gone to the wrong starting line, ran the wrong race, and missed a chance to a sizable prize. I wonder if that is a story of all of us, or most of us, chasing after prizes that are peddling or illusory. Meanwhile, we are missing out on the most important things at all. One of the most grueling of all bicycle races in the world is the Tour de France. A contestant in that event, Gilbert Duclos Lassalle, describes it in the National Geographic in an article called An Annual Madness. The race covers 2,000 miles, including some of France's most difficult mountainous terrain. Eating and drinking is done on the run, and there are extremes of heat and cold. To train for the event, Duclos rides his bicycle more than 2,000 miles a year, just to prepare. What kind of price makes people go through such hardship? $10,000? $100,000? The winner of Tour de France only received a special winner's jersey. What then motivates the contestants? Duclos sums it in this way. Why? To sweep through the triumph on the last day, to be able to say you finished Tour de France. That's the entire motivation. That's it. That's why people train for years, riding their bikes, thousands of grueling miles, just for the honor of wearing a special jersey.